St. John chapter 14,
and got to the book of John.
Then turn to the Old Testament book of Ezekiel chapter 26.
Amen.
Hold your finger in St. John 14, and we'll begin reading in Ezekiel 36, verse 26 for our golden text tonight. Hallelujah. 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 I'd like to say this before we start. It's good to see you. Some of you hadn't seen for a long time. And a bunch of you around here. And I just want you to know I love you. It's good to see you. And you better not run off when this meeting's over either. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and will give you a heart of flesh. Now we began talking last night about how that Adam and Eve were created in the image of God. And understanding that they were both created in the image of God, naturally looking, the natural evidence of the image that we see in the earth, they don't look alike. So therefore it must be deeper than the flesh, and deeper than the natural man. Jesus said that God is a spirit. They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Say those two words with me right now. Spirit and in truth. Don't forget those two words. Spirit, truth. Spirit, truth. Now, God created Adam and Eve to be spirit beings. Just like the image of God. And because of that, they had dominion over everything in the earth. They didn't have to take dominion over it. They didn't have to take authority over it. They just walked around and had it. And the biggest, you know, the biggest delight of the day was not going around and saying, bless God, we've got dominion, we've got authority over you. That wasn't the biggest thing of the day. The biggest thing of the day was the cool of the day. When God came to commune with this man and woman, that was the big deal of the day. See, because it was that communion. Now don't miss this. It was that communion. It was that fellowship. It was that union that produced the dominion and authority in the earth. It was that spiritual union. But now we understand that Adam and Eve, they both blew it because they stepped off the Word of God. They acted on something other than the Word of God. So the spiritual union was broken because of disobeying the truth. Now see, right from the beginning, you have the distinct presence of spirit and truth. Spirit beings created in the image and likeness of God. The only limits on Adam and Eve was the only limit God had, which was none. Well, I thought he couldn't sin. I thought that he couldn't partake of that tree of knowledge of good and evil. I'm going to tell you something. That sure wasn't a limitation. That was a blessing. He didn't have to take part of it. You know, we think, well, I can't do this and I can't do that. No, bless God, you don't have to do that. You don't need to get in there. We're privileged. The world gets tangled in that and they finally get there. Do this and have to do that. They have to do the things you say you don't get to do.
Come on.
Bless God, when the Bible says that He Himself bore my sickness and carried my diseases, I don't have to be sick.
God.
When it says that I'm set apart, touch not the unclean thing, you think I'm going to say, well, I don't get to touch the unclean thing? No, bless God. I'm privileged to be able, by the authority and by the spiritual union now provided to us through Christ Jesus, I don't have to touch it. And until you're of God, you're not only going to touch it, you're going to wallow in it. You listen to me, brother.
Yes.
You're not only going to touch it, you're going to wallow in it, and you have no other choice. All right. Adam and Eve, because they stepped off the truth, did something other than the Word of God. We talked about last night how that the Word of God was the umbilical cord of life for Adam and Eve. It kept the life flow of God alive on the inside of them as long as they were doers of it. As long as they were doers of it. And the tree was in the middle of the garden, and I said this last night, I believe it bears repeating. It was in the middle not to be a troublemaker, but to be a reminder to man that I'm serving God because I love Him, not because I have to, because I love Him. I got a choice every day to have everything God's got. That's what was in the middle of the garden. Every day they're coming and going, they had to pass that thing and just on the devil every time they passed it. But one day they just wasn't keeping their Bible study up, so to speak. They wasn't keeping, you know, they just wanted to step off the Word, just get out there and see what it's like. They got burnt. They saw what it's like. Now, ever since that time, God's heart's desire, His heart's throb, has been to restore that union, that oneness, that communion, that fellowship, that intimate knowledge between God and man. Man was created for the pleasure of God, and the earth was created for man. Don't ever forget that order. When you do, you just get out in left field somewhere, and you won't understand the Bible. Well, God said in Ezekiel again, to cure this thing, He said, I'll put a new heart also in you, and give you a new spirit and put within you. And I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. In other words, a heart that can be dealt with by God. A heart that is not callous. Ears that are not wax gross, okay? But then He said in verse 27, now this is what we got to understand. You stop at verse 26, and I'm going to tell you, you just well not to start it at all, okay? I mean, God didn't stop at 26, so we're not either, okay? Verse 27 said, and I will put my spirit, this is God talking. He said, I'll put my spirit within you and cause you. Say, cause me.
Cause me.
He said, I'll cause you to walk in my statutes. You shall keep my judgments and do them. Sounds a little bit direct to me. He said He would cause me and I shall. He didn't put that in verse 26. He didn't say He would cause me to keep His statutes and I shall keep His judgments and do them because I've got a new spirit. Adam and Eve didn't just keep the commandments of God because they had a spirit full of the life of God. They still blew it. But God said, because I'm placing myself on the inside of you, me personally, I personally, God Himself, signed in blood, said that I will see to it that you do my will. I will see to it, this is what it says to me, I'll see to it that the struggle's over for you to do what's in my word. The struggle is over tonight. If you're in this thing and you're saying, oh, I hope to God I can pray at least 15 minutes today. I hope to God I can witness to somebody. I hope to God that I can just do something to please God today. You're trying too hard. Faith isn't trying. Faith is trusting.
God.
Faith is trusting. Glory to God. We can't even get so wrapped up in, the new birth itself is powerful. The new birth itself, that's the Spirit of God working on the inside of you to cause you to be born again. He's in there then. But now we've got to, I'm dwelling on verse 27 tonight, so you would get a revelation of God being inside of you to cause you, make you, compel you to do His will. Not just every now and then suggest, well, I suggest you obey God today if you want anything from me. He's not in there doing it. He's in there every day just tugging at you. Remember Philippians 2:13? It is God that works in you. God's working. It's God that works in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. That's God that's at work in me, causing me to want to do, and then causing me to perform His good will. Now, turn to St. John, chapter 14. I can tell already this is going to be good tonight. Start with verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. Well, that's Jesus talking. Well, Right there, people read that, and they get a yoke of bondage put on their neck. I mean, there's no way they go swimming with that thing, because they'd sink right to the bottom. If you love me, keep my commandments. What was the problem in the Garden of Eden? What was the problem? They didn't keep the commandments of God. They blew it. God said, I'll pour my spirit in you that you'll never blow it again. But I blew it. Did you know we're coming to a place where we're not going to blow it anymore? Maybe you're not there today, but when we begin to rehearse in us what the Bible says about God in us, we don't have to blow it. We're like Jesus, aren't we? And when we do, you know, it's one thing to fall down. It's another just to wallow in the dirt.
That's right.
You know?
That's right.
But, you know, I'd go to help a fellow that fell down until I saw him wallowing in the dirt, and I would do one of two things. I'd cast the devil out of him or walk the other way. So when you get down, God operates with a fail-safe operation. He said, if you do sin, in other words, you don't have to. But now, just in case you do, confess your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Well, I'm glad of that. I'll tell you, I'll just be honest with you. I wore that one out. This is a new Bible. I'd get a new Bible back here in that part of my Bible. Back to James and 1 John back in that. It just got wore out. Particularly there in 1 John. Yeah. You want to learn how to live the things of God, you need to know 1 John.
Glory to God.
Now, if you love me, Jesus said, keep my commandments. Now, another place, and it is in 1 John, he said, my commandments are not grievous. So then they are not placing a yoke of bondage on us. When he's saying, keep my commandments, he didn't say, prove it, turkey. That's not what he said. He said, he did not say, if you love me, show me, Joe. That's not what he said. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. With Ezekiel 36:27 in view, he put his spirit in us to cause us and make us keep his commandments. We have no right at all reading that without what God had already said about keeping the commandments in mind. Do you know why Moses brought the Ten Commandments down from Mount Sinai? Do you know why? To prove to them that they could not live. The law was written to prove to them, you need grace. The law was written to prove to them, you're not living it. Moses brought the law down and said, here it is, God said, live it. They broke it. Everything that Moses had just brought down from the mat, they had already broken. They said, hey, we can do it, man. Lay it down there. We can do it. They had already broken every one. And, you know, there they go again, round and around and around. But God's infinite grace and mercy finally brought Jesus on the scene. Jesus says to us, if you love me, keep my commandments. He didn't stop there. And I will pray the Father, and he'll give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever.
Amen.
Well, again, he's talking about the Spirit of God. And if you'll know anywhere, if you will read all of the thought that the Spirit of God is conveying us, instead of just reading the Scripture, you know, verse 5, that's how the Holy Spirit must have talked. Verse 5, verse 6, chapter 7. No. As a matter of fact, to understand what I'm reading to you right now, I'm going to have to get over into chapter 15, chapter 16, and chapter 17 of St. John. We're going to do it right here in just a minute. He said, and I'll pray the Father, he'll give you another comforter. Now, the word another does not mean in place of me.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit did not come to replace Jesus. Mm-hmm. The word another means along with me. And I'll show it to you by the word of God right here. He said, along with me, I'll give you the comforter. I love what Oral Roberts says. He said, and T.L. Osborne agreed with him, so I'm in good company to agree with him. He said the Holy Spirit is another self of Jesus. And this is just good. I hope you got your Holy Ghost seatbelts on. He said, I'll send you another comforter. That he may abide with you how long?
Forever.
So then, just get some things out of your mind. And I'm getting off on tangent, but I won't stay there. I'll come right back. But when we get to heaven, the Holy Spirit still abides right there. He's forever. didn't say until the end of the age or end of the world. He said forever. Even the Spirit of Truth. If you believe in doing this, do this. Underline Spirit of Truth. I told you now to note that. Spirit of Truth. Even the Spirit of Truth. He's the what? He's the Spirit of Truth, praise God, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. But you know him. That word know doesn't mean that you're vaguely acquainted with. That means you intimately know him. You fellowship, commune with him. Well, Jesus said, he, God, is a spirit, and they that worship, the word worship means fellowship, commune with, know intimately God. Well, he said, verse 17 again, the Spirit of Truth whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him. For he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I'll not leave you comfortless, Jesus said. I'll come to you. Yet a little while and the world sees me no more, but you see me, because I live, you shall live also. At that day you shall know that I am in my Father. At what day is he talking about? At the day that you have the revelation in you that that's God in there by his Spirit. The Holy Spirit is here to cause us to know. He is not here to initiate us into a move. The Holy Spirit is not alive in our midst to, so we can say, hey, we're Pentecostal. He's not here to say, so we can say, hey, we're charismatic. He's not here so we can be the new wave Christianity. The Holy Spirit is here so that we can know. Know what? Know God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
At that day, you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I'm in you.
Oh, I just want to go overboard right here.
I want to go ahead and preach the end of this and then back up. At that day, what day? Right now. You know. Jesus is where?
In me.
That's not what he said first now. He's in the Father.
Oh,
he's in the Father. Then what did he say? Read that, Tom.
That day you shall know that I am in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. Oh, Lord.
You know Jesus is in the Father, but you'll also know you're in Jesus, and Jesus is in you, and we're all wrapped up in the Father. The Father. We're wrapped up in Him. Well, no wonder. No wonder Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I mean, we don't just have, and if you can grasp this, we do not merely just have the clothes of God on, the armor of God. We just got God.
Amen.
Well, let's read on. He that has my commandments and keepeth them. Now again, no, it's by his Spirit that we keepeth them. It's by his grace. It's not by any of our doings. By our doings we surely prove that we're a failure. And keepeth them, he it is that loves me. And he that loves me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. In other words, I will make more clear my presence. Look at verse 23. If a man love me, Jesus said, he will keep my words. Now this, catch this. I don't want to outrun you here. And my Father will love him. And we will come unto him and make our abode with him. I want you to read that last statement there with me, starting at "and we." Read it with me. And we will come unto him and make our abode with him. We who? The very presence of Father God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the
somebody comes up with a doctrine with no scriptural basis at all, that receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit means you receive the third person of the Godhead? Well, that's not what Jesus said. I want to believe what Jesus said.
Amen.
Now, what did he say? He said that we have received, because we're keepers of his commandments by his Spirit, that we have received all of the nature of God in us. All right, you talk about intimately knowing. Intimately knowing God. You know the best way to intimately know God by the Scripture? Look at the commandments. God says, "You won't, thou shalt not kill," because he's not a killer. God said, "Thou shalt not commit adultery," because he's faithful. God said, "Thou shalt not steal," because he's not a thief. Then he finally wrapped up all those commandments in one twofold commandment. Believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Love one another as I gave commandment. You see, you're seeing God. That's the most intimate revelation of God in the earth. That's God. Now, that's the commandment. But I want to tell you something. The keeper of the commandment is right there. He doesn't break his commandments. The very one that does not break his own commandments is right there. He's right there. The very one that does not break any of his commandments is already there. All of you. You're not trying to get him in there. At the moment you were born of God, he created life in your spirit, and he resided there. He said that his abode was made there. So, well, then why does it work for me, Brother Tussey? Because any Bible subject has to work by faith, and faith begins where the Word of God is known. Until you know it, you can't do it. What happened in the Garden of Eden? They cut off knowing God because they cut off the truth. Well, let's read on a little bit, help you further understand this. Look at chapter 15, verse 26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even, underline these next three words, the Spirit of truth. Well, there he is again. Even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me, and you also shall bear witness. Who's he talking to? He's talking to disciples. Well, are you a disciple of God? He said, you also shall bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. We differ not at all from the disciples there, because we have the infilling of the nature of God in us by His Spirit. But he said this, but when the Comforter is come, whom the Father will send unto you, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. He who? The Holy Spirit shall testify. But there's a conjunction there, and goes on to say, and you'll witness. The Holy Spirit testifying of Jesus is witnessing it through you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I'll say that again. The Holy Spirit testifying of Jesus is witnessing it through you. Now let me show you this in chapter 16, verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, there's those words again, underline them. When the Spirit of truth is come, he shall guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me. Who? Jesus. He shall glorify Jesus. For he shall receive of mine and show it unto you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore said I unto you that he takes of mine and shows it unto you. Now again, he is guarding. He is sheltering the fact that he never did anything without first he saw the Father do it, and never said a word unless he first heard the Father. He's guarding that. He's keeping his guard up there. Verse 16. And a little while you shall not see me, and again a little while you shall see me, because I go to the Father. Now, the Spirit of truth comes. He leads us into what? All truth. He is the leader. He is the guide into what? All truth. All of the Word of God, the Holy Spirit within you is the guide into it. The guide into understanding it. The guide into having wisdom in it. Okay? But I want you to know, Jesus went on to say that the Holy Spirit is coming without identity. He's coming transparent. He said, He shall not speak of Himself. He is all here only to repeat the words of Jesus and to guide us into the words of God. He comes without identity. Let's talk a minute about something that's very, very touchy in the body of Christ. Let's talk about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'm just going to say it like this, okay? Jesus said, I've never done anything unless I first saw the Father do it. But Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, I believe, says that Jesus is the image of the invisible God. Jesus also already said that God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. For Jesus is the image of the invisible God. Well then, Father God is the perfect will. But that is also where the Bible teaches where Jesus proceeded from. Jesus said, I proceeded from the Father. I came, in other words, why did Jesus come? To show us that men can have the will of the Father in the earth. Because in the Old Testament, they didn't see it. And Jesus saw what? The conveying of the will of the Father. Jesus came from the Father to convey His will that was not seen of men. I say it like this for me to understand it. I say, Father God thought it. Jesus showed it. And the Holy Spirit is giving me the energy to do it. The Holy Spirit is the energy to get it done. Because the Holy Spirit is not here to write a new doctrine. He's here to clear up what Jesus has already shown us from who? Preach it, praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus came to show us the will of the Father. The Holy Spirit is here to cause us to be doers of that will. Oh, glory. Yes, it excites me. Especially when you learn how to just live with the Father. Now, look at chapter 17, verse 17. Jesus is praying. He said, sanctify them by thy truth. He said, thy word is truth. Well, then thy truth is word. His word is His truth, and the truth is His word.
Right.
Well, then, if Jesus said that, then I'm safe. And if I say I'm preaching the word, I can also say I'm preaching the truth.
Amen.
But also, if I say that He's the Spirit of truth, I can also say He's the Spirit of the word.
Amen.
He's the Spirit of the Word. He is the Spirit of the Word of God. Okay? There's just a good example of how this works. How many of you, I don't want to see a show of hands, but you've ever sat down and just got comfortable over a cup of coffee or next to your fireplace, whatever really helps you to relax. And you open Shakespeare and you read Romeo and Juliet or any of that other stuff. And there you are, you're reading that. And particularly if you read the original manuscript.
Oh.
So here you are, you're reading that. But lo and behold, in your quiet time, meditating on Romeo and Juliet, and you just hoping that your love life could be as thus. Lo and behold, Shakespeare walks in the room. Now, no, he died 400 years ago. But he walks in the room, the spirit of Shakespeare. And he says, give me that. I'll read it to you. Can you imagine that?
Thank you.
Then on the other hand,
why in the world would I want to read a book about a man that died 2,000 years ago? Oh, they say God wrote this book. So you get serious. Well, I don't know if God wrote this book or not, but I sure do want to know God. You sit down there and read it. Somebody's been interceding for you for a matter of days. Somebody just walked in the door and just took a seat and said, I am the spirit of what you're reading. Let me read it to you. He said he'd guide us into all of this. You don't understand it because you haven't let him read it to you.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
You just, you know, you're in there trying instead of trusting. Don't get caught doing that. He's the spirit of the truth. Anywhere you'll be a proclaimer and a doer of his word, he's right. He's not only there in you, he just got out of you.
Amen.
To do something. To do something. Now let me show you something. I told you that to really understand what we're talking about, you have to read chapter 14, chapter 15, chapter 16, and chapter 17. I told you that. Now, I'm not going to ask you how many of you was here last night read that before you got here tonight. But now I want to read to you again, turn to chapter 14. I want to read to you the introduction to everything Jesus just taught. At the very end of chapter 17, Jesus gets very, very deep. He's talking spiritual, and he is comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But when he begins in chapter 14, he's using an illustration. Chapter 14, verse 1. But now he's talking about everything I just showed you out of the Word of God. St. John chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart, your spirit man, be troubled. You believe in, you trust in, you adhere to, and rely on God. Trust in and adhere to and rely also on me. Now that's what he said when he said believe. You ought never to read the word believe and hear anything but that. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Now, if you just read it to yourself, you said, whoopee, I got a mansion on the corner of Glory Street and Hallelujah Boulevard. And there won't be any knocks on my door. Would you just shut up and let God read it to you?
That's right.
Huh? Amen.
Now, what did we just read? Jesus said, in my Father's house. What is a house? It's an abode. It's somewhere you live. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. In my Father's abode are many dwelling places.
I hope I don't get raptured before it's done. I feel like I'm going. I at least want to finish this one. Glory to God.
He said, In my Father's abode are many places to dwell. He said, if it weren't the truth, I would have said it. I would have told you it wasn't the truth. He said, I'm going not to prepare a mansion for you, but a place. Where is our place? Look at verse 20. In that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and you're in me, and I'm in you. Keep your stinking mansion. I'm in the Father, glory to God.
Get it.
first the kingdom and the righteousness, and it just sticks to us. Everywhere we go, silver and gold and notes and land and property and cars, it's all over. We shake them off and give them to somebody, and here comes 100 more. Now, turn to the book of Acts, chapter 27. Well, before, hold your place in Acts, and before I read that, I'm going to read you something out of 2 Peter. Okay, hold your place there in Acts. Let's all praise God for 2 Peter.